listening to the Sports Circus, and I'm Mike Golick.
Welcome to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal, live from Las Vegas in the AMP TV studio, AAMP.TV. Today's show is brought to you by UppercutChops.com. Check out their tasty selection of all-natural, dry-aged USDA Prime Angus and Wagyu steaks. Wait till you see their best-in-class New York steaks, the filet mignons, and of course, the king of all, those cowboy cut and tomahawk ribeye steaks. Even the gourmet Angus and Wagyu beef burgers are likely going to be the best you've ever had. For more information, contact UppercutChops.com at 702-799-9935, 702-799-9935, again, 702-799-9935, or visit the selection from the comfort of your own home, right in your own living room, at www.uppercutchops.com and find out what's for dinner. All right, and a big welcome in to everybody listening in on our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates from coast to coast, Magic 97.9 FM right here in Las Vegas, and everybody also on Hotel Television, Cox, Comcast, Spectrum, Frontier, Wild Cable affiliates, social media, everybody watching also on Facebook and AAMP.TV, AMP TV. We have a very special guest. In fact, I'm just going to go ahead and let him introduce himself.
Oh, hello, Salvatore. This is Tim Brando coming to you live and direct, or maybe plausibly live if you're catching us a little later. From Chateau Brando. Good to be with you.
Yes, sir. And Tim, in case you've been living under a rock, everybody, you probably have heard him on television, I don't know, several thousand times calling baseball. No, I think you've done a little bit of baseball.
I've done quite a bit of baseball, yeah.
Right. College football, basketball, even golf, baseball. He's done it all. And Tim, the award-winning broadcaster, thanks for joining us today.
Happy to be with you, Sal. I, what took so long? My people just didn't get in touch with your people, I guess.
We had to wait until the Final Four was over and everything else, right?
Right. And I know you've gotten all the scoop on me from G-Man because he's a regular. So you probably know all my broadcast secrets from the hardwood, you know, the origin of the Iron Unkind and all that. So we can skip past a lot of the remedial stuff and get on to the big stuff today.
Just, you know, I'm looking around the room behind you, and, you know, I've got a few props here. They are what they are, but I'm trying to see everybody watching on television and on social. I see all kinds of football helmets. I even see a 1979 Pittsburgh Pirates baseball hat.
Yeah, from Phil Garner. The scrap iron gave it to me years ago when he was managing and I was calling games. I was in high school. I was a baseball player, played through American Legion, gave it up as I was in college because I was on a speech and debate scholarship and I could always talk better than play, but I was decent. I was a slow white lefty with occasional power, could go deep but would never get a leg hit. That was my bio. but I love the game. And like a lot of guys that grew up, in the 60s, before there was cable television or anything like ESPN, the only way to be a full-time broadcaster was to have a baseball job. So, you know, the dream originally always was to do baseball so you could work round the clock and fill in the rest of the year with other opportunities. And then this thing called ESPN came along and sped up my resume a little bit. And I bypassed working in radio for a major league franchise. But I did work for the Braves, got this World Series ring in 95, working with Ernie Johnson Sr. during my years at Turner Sports when they had the regional network Sports South, which later became Fox South as part of a sale years later. But those years with Ernie were tremendous. You know, 94, the Black Sunday, August 11th, 1994, then the World Series in 95 and the World Series in 96. And so I did about 50 games a year, which was just the perfect number because I was doing every other sport known to man, working around the clock and through the calendar. But when ESPN initially got Major League Baseball, I did quite a bit of it in 90, 91, 92, before I left in 94. So, but I haven't done baseball since I left the Braves and went to CBS in 1996. So it's been a long time. Right. And the sport lost me for a period, as it lost a lot of people. But I am slowly, as I get into my mid-60s, I just turned 66. I'm slowly, romantically coming back to baseball, largely because of the nostalgia and what it reminds me of. Not what's going on currently, because it, you know, I'd be fired in a heartbeat if I were calling a game like the one with Kershaw last week, where he's got a perfect game and because of analytics, they take him. I would have been fired immediately for giving a comment about that. But it's the nature of the beast now, you know, just that's how baseball is transformed. And I get all that. I watch it. I got a lot of friends that still call it. And I find myself watching MLB Network because I like the way they go from game to game in the evenings. And I love catching up with some of my old colleagues who are still at it, you know, and, get, you know, and whether it's on radio or on television, I really enjoy, you know, watching snippets of the games from time to time. So I'm sort of slowly coming back to baseball, but I don't think any of your viewers would associate me with the game. they associate me with college football and college basketball, and that's okay with me.
Right. Probably, you know, probably the most recognizable voice in college hoops for sure. You know, the whole baseball thing. Look, I have a real problem with the way Clayton Kershaw was treated in his outing with that perfect game. And you know what's worse? Imagine this. There was, you may recall, back in the mid-2000s, there was during the White Sox team that won the World Series, Tadahito Oguchi is second baseman. So he is a manager of, I think, this Shibu Lions over in Japan, or Lotte, that's what it is. Anyway, so his pitcher, one of his pitchers pitched a perfect game, and then his next outing, he's eight innings into a perfect game.
Unreal.
Mind you, this could be history of history, two perfect games in a row, and what does he do? He goes to the pen and pulls him out. Oh, I mean, man. Are you kidding me? I mean, how do you do that? It's unbelievable. It's that's unconscionable.
Like, that's like pinch hitting for Satahara O when he's gone 4-for-4 with four home runs and he's coming up for his fifth at bat.
It's unbelievable.
It's like, why would, I mean, how could you possibly do that? Like I said, the period that I was, and that was sort of a career hiccup period for me when I was working with Ernie, but it was a blessing to work with Ernie Sr., one of the nicest men and one of the greatest broadcasters of baseball ever. He's the father of Ernie Jr., who's my age. And he had retired from the TBS booth with Skip and Pete and Don Sutton. But they talked him into, Ted and Jane talked him into coming back to Sports South because they were going to give him a chance to work with his son, Ernie Jr. Well, the guys that were running TBS had other ideas. They had the Goodwill games and a bunch of other things, and Ernie couldn't do the games. So they called the old left-hander out of the bullpen, knowing that I was doing Hawks games for them. I did about 52 Hawks games during that period, and I did the NBA playoffs for Turner back then. And they said, would you like to join Ernie Sr. for like 40-some-odd games? And I said, oh, my God, absolutely. But I can't imagine what he would have thought, or other broadcasters of that generation would have thought, seeing that take place and not commenting on it. We had Greg Maddux in his best bid to have a no-hitter in Houston. He had gone eight full innings with a no-no. Now, not perfect game, but a no-no. He'd never had one in his career, never did have one in his career. And I remember I was doing the middle innings in the seventh, and I said something about it, and Ernie just, he looked at me like, kid, you didn't do that. You didn't. I said, well, I mean,
you hoped some.
Kid, you don't do that. So he kept it going until the top of the ninth, when Jeff Bagwell led off with a home run, first pitch home run in the ninth. And he never let me forget that. Ernie, he never let me forget that. And so, yeah, that's rarefied air. That's just, and I don't care that Kershaw was okay with it. I don't even care that he was okay with it.
He wasn't okay with it. Tim, he wasn't okay with it at all. Well, did you read the comments afterwards?
He acted as if in the aftermath, as though he were okay with
it.
But I did, for those that said that, I didn't agree with it at the time. But even after he said what he did shortly thereafter in the clubhouse, I was like, no, there's no way. But again, today, the people that are making the decisions on who broadcasts the games, especially when they're locally broadcasts, they want homers, and they don't want any questions of anything that's going on. And that's what baseball is all about. How in the hell can you just let that go by and not question it? You know, again, I could never work in Major League Baseball because I wouldn't last past my first inning questioning a decision that a manager might make. That is what the essence of baseball is. I mean, can you imagine a Harry Carey or Jack Buck not being able to editorialize in the middle of their calls back in the day on KMOX?
I mean, I know. I couldn't agree more. Listen, when we come back from break, I want to talk a little bit more about this because, look, there are things that you can say, things you're not supposed to say. But at the end of the day, from a player standpoint, the players ought to be able to say what they want to. Instead, they're being bottled up by the media. Back here with the great Tim Brando in just a few minutes on the Sports Circus. Lots more to come, folks. Don't go anywhere.
Ah, can't be fun at the old ballpark, friends. High pop fly. That one be a home run in a phone booth. I don't know what the big deal about Cracker Jack is. Did you ever go and buy a pack of Cracker Jack thinking you'd get a prize and find no prize in the box? Here's the pitch. That might not sound important to some people, but when you're a little kid, especially from humble origin, and they cheat you out of a prize, there's a bouncing ball. Second baseman has a Barbary over the first. It's hard to think in laudatory terms of the product.
I think if there was an occasional box of Cracker Jacks that found no prizes for the little Harry Carey many years ago.
You got that right. And boy, when a box of Cracker Jack to me meant a lot of money. Here's a pitch, bounce foul. That's the most asinine marketing I've ever heard of. One ball, one strike. These guys say, well, you sing about Cracker Jack. I said that. I only sing it because it's in the song. Here's a pitch foul back. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised, even to this day, some youngsters who buy a box of Cracker Jack don't find a prize in the box. One ball, two strikes, two out. Well, if you're going to talk about our congressman being crooked, here's a pitch foul out of play. Why not talk about commercial products that don't do what they represent to do? They told me when they hired me it was a temporary job. Born and raised in St. Louis, and you can imagine the Cardinals were my favorite team from the day I could remember. And all of a sudden, the miracle of life, I'm broadcasting card games. Yeah. I own the town and broadcast them for 25 years, and I thought they're going to give me a gold watch, and they gave me a pink slip. Then I went out to work for Charlie Finley for a year, and that's par for the course. Came to Chicago, and I was with the White Sox 11 years, and now with the Cubs. Never missed a game, never missed a time at bat, never missed a half inning that I was supposed to do. You know, Chicago is such a marvelous city. Hey, we got some Chicago people. You know, you never succeed in this business until you've had the experience of working with a terrible hangover. Not until you've been able to come through with flying colors under those circumstances can you consider yourself a professional. Lord knows, I've had more than my share of hangovers.
There's a drive. Way back.
It might be. It could be. And it is. Holy cow. This crowd is wild.
Hey, everybody. This is Brian Urlacher. Welcome back to the Sports Circus.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your ringmaster, Sal, live from Las Vegas in the AMP TV studio, AAMP.TV. This segment brought to you in part by Legal Shield, providing legal protection and peace of mind. Legal Shield can help with traffic tickets, texting and driving, DUIs, court appearances, estate planning. Maybe a manager pulled you out of a game a little bit too fast and you went after him with a baseball bat. And you need an attorney. Contact Legal Shield for more information. 213-245-1305. That's 213-245-1305. Again, 213-245-1305. Or check them out online for more information at nocourt.us. That's www.nocourt.us. All right, welcome back to everybody listening in on our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates from coast to coast. Big hello to our friends out in Honolulu on CBS Sports 1500 KHKA. That's home of the 49ers, the San Francisco Giants, and the Alabama Crimson Tide. Big hello to our friends over in Southern California, NBC News, the NBC Financial. Over in Fairley, Louisiana, Natchez, Mississippi, 107.1 The River. Thanks for joining us. Also in Las Vegas, Magic 97.9 FM. Over in Auburn, Alabama, WAUD, home of the world champion Atlanta Braves. And in Atlanta, WDJY 99.1 FM. Everybody else on Cox, Comcast, Spectrum, Frontier, Wild Cable affiliates, thanks for joining us, as well as hotel television and in social media. In fact, we're streaming on Facebook here with a great Tim Brando, and it's the award-winning sportscaster. He's kind of done it all. And, you know, Tim, in the last segment, and even in between, it was about the whole pitch count idea.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Which it drives me absolutely insane. And I would have been fired probably before you for opening my mouth.
Yeah.
I don't even understand the idea how these managers can focus on these analytics instead of actually watching the game. Whatever happened to watching the game?
You know, the origin of it really, Sal, began much sooner than a lot of people think. I know a lot of baseball fans, Major League fans, don't necessarily remember watching a lot of college baseball in the 80s, but I was doing the College World Series before the College World Series was cool. I was doing it with Jim Cott and Joe Morgan.
The lefty.
The great Sam Rosen was the other broadcaster for a period. And then Mike Patrick did some games. I was working with Freddie Lynn. Steve McCaddy worked with me one year, the former A's pitcher, which was with Billy Ball in the early 80s and later a pitching coach, as you know. And in those days, there were a lot of pitchers at the collegiate level because pitchers that were really great coming out of high school all went to the MLB. They didn't go to college. So the ones that they got, few and far between, that were great, Clemens being one of them, Calvin Schiraldi being another, and a few others, they were pitching a lot of pitches for guys like Gustafson, the coach at Texas, or Mike Martin, the legendary coach at Florida State. And I remember watching and listening to guys like Peter Gammons just ripping these college coaches for having these guys go for 115, 125 or more pitches in a game. And, you know, that was too much. And I'm sure a lot of arms were thrown out, similar to, say, for instance, David Clyde, who I actually played against or I was in the dugout against as a high school sophomore in Louisiana. We played in a tournament over in East Texas, and Clyde was from the Houston area, a great pitcher, phenom, destined to be the first pick by Bob Short and the Rangers. You remember that story about bringing him up immediately and throwing his arm out. He was 37 days shy of claiming his pension, you know, when his career ended with the Cleveland Indians. But I think all of that has been, they've overloaded the other way now. Okay. The notion that there would be a bullpen day for a starting rotation is just baffles my mind. That you can't have a full four or five man rotation. No, no, no. We're going to have a bullpen day because these guys need to get their reps. That just blows me away. But it started at that level. And now what you're seeing is the college game has evolved into me a much better game to watch than Major League Baseball. They do have pitchers now, and great pitchers for the last 5 to 10 years have been coming through Major League, into the Major Leagues from college. Okay. See guys like Price and a few others on the Vanderbilt staff and many others that have come through and done very well for themselves. So college baseball has evolved, I think, into a game where you still see guys hitting behind the runner. You do see safety squeezes. You know, you see the game that we are reminded of from time to time. You don't see it in big league ball anymore. You just don't. They're playing a game that we are no longer familiar with. And that's sad to me.
It's tragic.
Yeah, it is. It very much so is.
The game of baseball, as I was a kid, I will tell you, like everybody else, as a little kid, I wanted to run up to those players. Hey, could you sign the ball? Could you sign the ball? You know, here, yeah. Please, you know, whatever. Decide whatever you want on there. But nowadays, yeah. You know, it's not even like that, because you think about the players when you and I are probably about 10 years apart, but we still have the same ideals of baseball from back in right. The day. Look, right. A starting rotation, those are the guys that went front to back. Period. Right. And now if you had to go to the pen, bring your lefty or your righty, whatever, well, that just showed everybody how weak your starting rotation was.
Yeah.
And I came up playing ball on a playground, and we would throw against a painted box on a wall. We'd play a one-on-one game, and we'd throw till our hoses were hanging, but then we'd still be out there throwing again and again every day, pain or no pain. But what it did, number one, it gave us the ability to do what? First, face adversity. Pitchers today don't have to face adversity. Oh, little Billy is coming out of the game in the third inning because he's already given up a run, and we don't want that to hurt his earned run average. It may affect his payroll. What kind of crap is that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I think the competitor in you, all right, as a player, is impacted when you don't have to face any adversity whatsoever. Again, I don't like sounding like the old curmudgeon that didn't change or adapt with the times, but it's impossible not to when discussing the way Major League Baseball is played. And I'll hear it every now and then when I listen to, I will stay for every pitch when I hear Costas and Cott working together on MLB Network, because I've known Kitty Cat for a long time. I respect Bob and his understanding of the history of Major League Baseball. And they will even, in their own subtle way, point out, gee, we're going to do that now, really? And because they're who they are, and they're working for MLB Network, and the MLB wants them to discuss these matters, they can get away with it. But a guy that's just working for his local team, he can't do that. You know, he can't bring up some of these thoughts. I've talked to many young broadcasters, mentored many of them, that are in Major League Baseball today. And they'll tell you that they can't even get the organization doesn't even want them around the batting cage during BP. Hell, BP is where I would pick up all the nuggets that I needed for a game, either talking to the hitting coach or to a couple of the players if they looked my way. I didn't seek them out, but I would, if they happened to walk by and say hello, kind of open a conversation, then I knew I could talk to them. There are broadcasters now of the teams that are being told, stay the hell away from batting practice. That makes no sense to me.
I don't get it. I mean, look, you want your broadcasters to be a part of the game, but also to want them to have a little bit of intimate knowledge that the audience doesn't know. And exactly what you're saying, you could pick that up around the cages.
It's all about access.
Friendly around the cages.
Yeah, you know? The broadcaster represents the conduit between the viewer, listener, and the player. And whatever you can pick up from the players or hitting coaches or pitching coaches, that's the access that makes your job valuable. So, but that's what's going on. I mean, that's just what's going on out there. This sort of protective covenant that the organization has over keeping information about its team's players is remarkable.
It's funny you say that, because I have an affinity for hockey. I love hockey. I could never skate. I couldn't skate to save my life. I mean, very embarrassing, I can assure you that. But what I will tell you is from a just going to a game. So I'm a local season ticket holder here in Las Vegas, and I watch the pregame skate, and I watch where the shots are being missed by the goalie, just like any other team could say. So it's not like a broadcaster is going to divulge anything. If you're watching the other team in the batting cages in baseball, you know maybe a guy's having trouble hitting a ball that's up. Or he's having a trouble with a ball that's away low and away from the plate. And you could see this already. It's not like you're trying to divulge anything here.
Right.
So in the last minute of the segment, tell me your worst case scenario for a broadcaster before you go on air at a baseball game.
Well, I think it's just that. I think it's not being able to get the information that you want and need. I remember when the batting practice used to be where everyone had fun. I'll tell you a quick story. Harry Carey is doing a game on July 3rd. I'm going to do the 4th of July game with Ray Knight between the Pirates, who are loaded with Bonilla and Bonds and those guys, and the Cubbies. And he comes walking up to me. Hey, you're that kid that does impressions of me on that ESPN thing. And I'm like, that's right. And I said, Tim Brando, he says, I love it when you do me, you know, and this is in the middle of batting practice. And then some other people came over, started talking. Jim Riggleman was managing the Cubs at the time. He comes over and starts talking. You know, that's what makes being there and being able to tell a story like that and what it brought from other players and coaches. That's what makes it special. Baseball is an everyday game. It's not a 1 week explosion like football or a here and there NBA kind of situation, college basketball. Those kinds of stories is what separates Major League Baseball.
Absolutely. Great stories, and we want more of that when we come back from break with award-winning sports broadcaster and a man of the world. We'll just call him everything you can think of, but all kinds of great stuff in the room, too. That's Tim Brando. Back here in a few minutes, folks. That's more to come. Don't go anywhere. I'm your Ringmaster Sal of the Sports Circus, a primetime, nationally syndicated television, radio, sports, and entertainment show. The Sports Circus covers topics others are too scared to talk about. There's no other primetime show like it on here that'll punch you in the face and you'll beg for more. Join me, Hall of Famers, World Champions, and All-Star Celebrity Guests for Chaos and Controversy here on Libsyn and all podcast platforms, plus thesportscircus.com. Remember, folks, it's a circus and we prove it every day.
Can your IRA stand up to the next financial crisis that our top economists are saying is at our doorsteps? By allocating a percentage of your IRA into physical gold and silver with a tax-free rollover, you can diversify and safeguard your holdings from turbulent markets and economic downturns by putting your IRA back on the gold standard. Find out how to safeguard your assets with a tax-free rollover with a Genesis Gold IRA, the only IRA that can hold physical precious metals. Call now for your free gold and silver report. Protect your IRA today with one simple phone call and learn how to qualify for up to $10,000 in free silver. Call Genesis Gold Group, empowering faith-driven stewardship. 800-932-5517. 800-932-5517. 800-932-5517. That's 800-932-5517.
Do you own a timeshare? Well, face the facts. You made a mistake. You made a bad purchase. A timeshare is not an investment. It's a money pit that continues forever. If you use your timeshare, that's great. But if you don't and you want to legally get out of your contract, call my friends right now at the Timeshare Exit Hotline. They're an experienced team of lawyers who help good people like you get out of a timeshare contract that they just don't want. Don't throw away your money on maintenance fees. Use it for things you really want. We can help you end your timeshare contract and stop the money drain immediately. If you're ready to move on with your timeshare, call our team right now.
Cancel your timeshare now with a free call. 800-298-3173. 800-298-3173.
800-298-3173. That's 800-298-3173.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. This is Scott Spezio, two-time World Series champ.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal, live from Las Vegas in the AMP TV studio, AAMP.TV. This segment brought to you in part by Kelly Vegas, helping people create and host their very own radio, TV, or multimedia talk shows. Kelly Vegas can help with everything people need to get out of sitting in hours of traffic, commuting back and forth to the same old boring job, and host their very own talk show in their very own home studio. For more information, contact Kelly Vegas at 949-445-1119. That's 949-445-1119. Again, 949-445-1119. Or visit them online for more information at kellyvegas.com. That's www.calivegas.com. An astounding round of applause for Kelly Vegas. You know, they've been with us for about, I don't know, 5.5 years. We've been doing this rodeo for then. And I got to tell you, we're here with the great Tim Brando. And, you know, Tim, with all of the sponsor reads and all the commercials that you've been a part of, I can't imagine how many reads you've actually done. 10,000, 20,000, some crazy amount.
Yeah. Yeah, and I can tell you've been at it yourself for quite a while, and finding something within the copy that you can relate to, you know, pop culture, you know, you go there, because if you don't, you get bored with just reading it. You know, that's how you kind of keep it light, keep it entertaining. Yeah, I've had my fair share.
I would imagine.
My father was in the television business when it first went on the air. That's sort of how I got my start as a kid, was just being around my father. And sponsor of one of his shows was Wholesome Bread. And the read was for the best in bread by Wholesome Bread. And one day on live TV, because there was no tape in the late 50s, he said, for the breast in bed by...
That's hilarious. For the breast in bed.
I'm guessing he's not the only one that had that at some point. We just can't document it because there was no videotape back then.
Well, I'm sure that the writers of this had that in their mind at some point too. Come on now. Yeah. How could you not?
Right. Exactly.
How could you not? Yeah. So, all right. Whether it's this sport or that sport, whatever, how different? Now, I don't know. I'm not a big golfer. I mean, I'm horrific on a golf course. I've played 13 rounds in my life. I've hit a person. I've hit a van, a couple of buildings, whatever. But it is what it is. Mm-hmm. But when you're calling something like the Masters, how different is that than calling a baseball or basketball playoff game? Besides the excitement, but how do you contain yourself?
Well, first and foremost, I think golf is the most difficult sport to cover on television. And when I say that, I mean the totality of the coverage. When you think about the number of participants that are on the course at the same time, the broadcasters, whether they're on the 18th tower, if they're covering a hole, or if they're on the ground, the job of the producer to select where to go, be live, and then where to go to tape. You know, 80% of a golf show, your shots that you're going to be witnessing at home are coming off videotape. They're not live. So the selection process and holding this videotape and this videotape, and we're going to go to that after we take this shot live, all that stuff, as a broadcaster of it, I think it's first and foremost important that you, A, know the game well enough to know what not to say. And that's one of the reasons why more and more you see nothing but former players or teachers that are participating in the coverage, and that the only quote unquote announcer would be the guy in the 18th tower, the Dan Hicks or the Jim Nance, or Mike Tirico, if you will. Most of the other guys involved are either former players or teachers, or possibly even architectural golf guys, you know, that have helped put layouts together you know, for either Ben Crenshaw or Jack Nicklaus. When you do have announcers at certain holes, and CBS through the years has, with Vern Lundquist at 16, Augusta, for a while it was Bill McAtee, now it's Andrew Catalan at 14, and then Ian Baker Finch at 17, you're able to get an ensemble to work in unison. So it's not just a announcer and an analyst. It's an ensemble of talent working together. And you just wind back the pace of play in golf being what it is. You just dial everything back. And I remember the first time I did the Masters digitally. I never did it over the air, but I did it for 4 years digitally, which became a very big deal because so much of the Masters, as you know, is not seen on television until the late afternoons, even on Thursday and Friday. So if you want to watch early golf at 10 in the morning, you got to be watching, you know, masters.com and getting it digitally. And I had some people, even Billy Payne, who was the executive chairman of the Greencoats back in those days, a former tight end with Vince Dooley in the 60s. He's a big SEC guy. He never thought that was who I was. He didn't, was like, I've never heard you do golf. And I said, well, I love the game. I enjoy it. I'm really happy to be here. But you just dial it back and you work from shot to shot with the guy that's with you. And that's just it. Tennis is sort of the same way. You don't talk during the point. And I did US Open tennis with Tony Trabert in the early 2000s, you know, on one of the courts at CBS. You know, obviously you had Inberg and at one time Pat Summerall that did the main court. But the outer courts went to someone else, and I was thrilled to do that. But you don't talk during the points. What you're there to do is to help the analyst summarize, get him into his replay or her into her replay, and then take us to break and get us out of the break and summarize and get us going again. The art of play-by-play, or even calling it that in television, is sometimes a misnomer. It really should be live event host. Because you're really not, play-by-play is a radio term. In television, you're a setup man. And in football, it's a little bit more rat-a-tat-tat with a lot of emotion and energy. Yard line, who carried, who made the tackle, what down is it? All that comes into play. But in golf or in a sport like tennis, there's a lot of time for you to lay out and for you to paint the right word pictures to go with what we're watching. And it's a little bit like that with figure skating too, or gymnastics, if you're watching the Olympics. And I did my fair share of the Olympic sports in my early days at ESPN. I never worked in Olympics, which is kind of shocking given all the Olympic sports that I've covered through the years. I used to work a lot of US Olympic festivals, which was America's Olympics and all that. And you're doing sports that, you know, are obscure, many of them. And you just have to learn the glossary of that particular sport. Every sport has its own glossary. Imagine if a young talented guy were doing hockey and he didn't know when the puck went up against the boards that it's not a wall. You could just as easily call the boards a wall, but if you did, they'd throw you out immediately. And anyone that's in goal, given the sport, based on the sport's glossary, could either be a goaltender, goalkeeper, or goalie. Now, if you say the wrong one in the wrong sport, you've lost all credibility. So you just need to know, you know, the glossaries of those sports that are a little bit more obscure. And I think that the preparation for those sports is different, because you are not just preparing for the games and the teams and the individuals that are participating and coaching, but you're also gearing up for an audience that, you know, loves this sport. And you can't screw it up by using the wrong terminology. You know, you're going to lose them the moment you throw out a word that doesn't apply with what they're watching. I was in fear when I did hockey for the first time. I'm the only guy born south of the Mason-Dixon line that's ever done hockey. And right. I did hockey in the 1985 U.S. Olympic Festival. And instead of having a spotter for names of players making a tackle, I had a spotter for different terminologies and penalties. Like, for instance, I didn't know the difference really between icing and offsides. Okay. I really didn't know. You watch a hockey event, and if you're from the South and you've never seen it, okay, was that icing or was that offsides? I'm really not sure. So I would tell my spotter, point to one and do so definitively, because I've got to sound like I'm confident that that was offsides or that was icing. And I've never been so glad to get off the air in my life. I called one game, and I went back into the compound, and Jim Simpson, the legendary first face of ESPN back in those days, he'd been at NBC for years, he said, "Well, you sounded good, Tim. What was it like?" And I said, "Well, Jim, let's just say I've never been happier to say so long for now. Let's go back to Jim Simpson." That's it. And then he started telling me an old story about being in Grenoble at the Olympics, working with Kurt Gowdy. And that's how you survive in our business, is by making sure that you've done either the homework on the teams or on the sport that you're covering.
Yeah, I'm not so sure that here in our last 30 for the segment, I'm not so sure that I could contain myself, even if I'm calling a round of golf. I don't know if I could whisper into a microphone or where, because I'm a high energy guy. And the same thing with tennis, just like in bowling. I grew up with a bowling ball in my hand. There was Chris Schenkel and Nelson Burton Jr. calling the Saturday. Right. And so I don't know
Live
if I could
call her on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Right. Right. And I don't know if I could contain myself. I don't know. I called a couple of baseball games for the local team here for our College of Southern Nevada baseball team, which is very good. And I found myself almost yelling into that little fuzzy microphone in front of me, and it sounded distorted. Anyway, we're going to be back here in a few minutes with the great Tim Brando. Folks, don't go anywhere. This is good stuff. Back in a few minutes on the surface.
Do you owe the IRS $10,000 or more in back taxes? Are you being audited or investigated? Has the IRS sent you a letter demanding payment? You may not owe what they claim. Make this free call to the Tax Doctor now. Let them negotiate with the IRS on your behalf.
800-296-1209. 800-296-1209. That's 800-296-1209.
If you're trying to quit drinking or doing too many drugs, listen to me. You don't know me and we'll never meet. I had a problem like you once. I drank and used to party a little too much till it got out of control and almost ruined my life. I realized I needed help to fix my problem before it totally destroyed me. If you've tried to fix your drinking and drug problem and you know you can't do it alone, you need to call the National Treatment Advisors. They'll immerse you into a 30-day program to replace your old habits with new habits and totally change your life. And if you have PPO private health insurance, the entire program may be covered. Fix your problem right now before it gets any worse. Get clean. Call now and learn more.
800-957-6209. 800-957-6209. 800-957-6209. That's 800-957-6209.
I'm your Ringmaster Sal of the Sports Circus, a primetime, nationally syndicated television, radio, sports, and entertainment show. The Sports Circus covers topics others are too scared to talk about. There's no other primetime show like it out here that'll punch you in the face and you'll beg for more. Join me, Hall of Famers, World Champions, and All-Star Celebrity Guests for Chaos and Controversy here on Libsyn and all podcast platforms, plus thesportscircus.com. Remember, folks, it's a circus and we prove it every day.
If you have diabetes, listen up. If you have insurance, you can qualify for a continuous glucose monitor. With a CGM, you can continuously track your levels and trends and spend more time in range, significantly lowering your A1C. More importantly, a CGM eliminates the one thing most people with diabetes hate, painful finger sticks. Order your new continuous glucose monitor today. If you use insulin and if you've seen your diabetes care provider within the last 6 months, you may qualify for your own CGM right now. We'll do all the insurance paperwork and deliver your new CGM at little or no out-of-pocket cost to you. Medicare and most insurances will cover your CGM, so don't wait. Have your insurance handy and call the Aptiva Medical CGM Health Hotline right now.
800-320-2751. 800-320-2751. 800-320-2751. That's 800-320-2751.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. This is Scott Spezio, two-time World Series champ.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal, live from Las Vegas in the AMP TV studio, AAMP.TV. In case you don't know what that is, folks, that's All Ages Media Programming.television. AAMP.TV. This segment brought to you in part by the College of Southern Nevada Athletics, CSNCoyotes.com for upcoming games and event tickets. Make sure you check out your seating assignment and go on over to the Henderson campus right here in the Las Vegas Valley. Great baseball. In fact, baseball's National League MVP, Bryce Harper, played ball there, plus several other really good ball players. And guess what? The women's softball, one of my favorites, is also one of those venues that you have a great stadium, great food, free parking, and it's just a good family place. Go bring the family out to the College of Southern Nevada, and that's over in Henderson, right here in the Las Vegas Valley, and check them out, csncoyotes.com for your tickets. Again, csncoyotes.com. All right, welcome back to everybody. You know who you are. All right, we're here with the great Tim Brando, and we've got some great stories. Now, we need to do this on a regular basis, because I got to tell you, these are fun from a player's perspective, from a broadcaster's perspective. I've got to ask you, have you, in your mind, where to draw a line where something is a sport or a pastime?
No, I've never felt that way about any sport that I've ever covered. I've always felt that they were sports. You know, a lot of my buddies would tell you that golf is a pastime and it's a game, not a sport. That's baloney. If you don't understand after watching golfers play and being on practice tees to see how good they are and the athletic pass that you have to make to hit the ball the way they hit it on a consistent basis, that is athletic. You know, some clowns have actually, and almost all of them are guys that never play or never really attempted to play. Or been around those that do and do it, you know, at an exemplary level. Some people feel that way about auto racing, and probably more so than any sport, the endurance of someone, you know, dealing with the adversity of fatigue and heat in the middle of putting their lives on the line, turning left. Yeah, I get that. The only sports that I've never called, Sal, are horse racing and auto racing.
Oh,
everything
I love horse
else,
racing.
Even track and field. I did quite a bit of track and field and gymnastics, NCAA level, Olympic style versions of those given sports. I did all of that. And I never felt that one was I did ping pong, for crying out loud. And those guys, I mean, it's amazing what they do. You know, at the highest level, there's a certain, that it's an athletic endeavor. So no, I think maybe this thing, I've not done it. I've watched, okay, cornhole and axe throwing. Those two, I think, might be considered a pastime. I've never done it, so I really don't know. Maybe if I got closer to it, I would feel differently about it. But I've been around guys from our truck that after they get through with the setup are playing some cornhole. And to me, that looks like a pastime.
Right.
But I've not been involved in one where I ever questioned the legitimacy of, you know, the athletic talent that you had to have to do it.
Right. You know, there is a difference, I believe, between skill games and certain sports. Yeah. And right. The reason I say that, and I can say this is my opinion, and I'm sticking to it. If you can drink a beer and do it at the same time, something tells me, in my opinion, it's not a sport. I mean, this is why I say that with cornhole.
Yeah. If you're playing golf and you're imbibed and, you know, you've had a few and you're in a golf cart, yeah, that is a pastime, that version of golf. But if you're trying to score, and that's where I am as a golfer, I'm a, you know, an 8-9 handicap, and I'm always trying to break 80 every time I play.
Wow.
I seldom do it, but on the occasions when I do, I'm ecstatic. And I'll go home and I'll tell my wife, boy, are you going to have fun tonight? We're going to enjoy ourselves. I broke into that. But it is true. I mean, I really work on my game when I've got time to work on it, which is this time of year. You know, I live on a golf course for a reason. And I'll play 3 times a week minimum, you know, through the spring and summer months. And then they go back into the mothballs once toe meets leather and we're playing football and college basketball during the winter months. So, and it's really the joy of my life, besides chasing grandbabies, which I have 4 between the ages of 1 and 5, that I'll soon have on the beach with me in on the Floribama coast here in mid-May. But if I'm not chasing grandbabies, I'm chasing golf balls. You know, that's what I love to do. And I walk the course when I play. I'm not in a golf cart. I sometimes will play with a guy that's in a golf cart and walk while he rides. But I'm going to walk my golf course and get my 12,000-13,000 steps in, you know, over the 6,600 yards or more that I might be playing that day.
You mentioned a place near and dear to my heart, and that is that Floribama coast, because
yeah.
I like going down to the mullet toss. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. And you know what time of year it is without time stamping this. This yeah. is the glory time of the year yeah. over right. I got to tell you, my favorite beach in these United States is Destin. But I don't mind going a little bit to the west and going over to Floribama and being yeah. down there with 20,000 of my closest friends, throwing a mullet across the state line, seeing how far into Alabama I could throw it. It's all for charity, of course. All good yeah. stuff. How many times have you thrown the mullet?
A few. And usually I've never been of sound mind or body while throwing the mullet.
Is that a sport?
Floribama is a really unique spot. Joe Gilchrist, the proprietor there, is a friend of mine. And I played in Kenny Stabler's celebrity golf tournament that he used to have on Mother's Day weekend every year until I think maybe 2007 or 2008, and which was over at the Grand Hotel in Point Clear, Alabama, just on the other side of the bay. And we would go down to Fort Walton, Destin Beach right after that when I was younger. And then we went a little bit further east to 30A, which is gorgeous and magnificent, you know, Okaloosa Island through there. But I love going to Orange Beach, and I take my family there, my sons-in-laws and my grandkids. We go for a week every spring, and it's just awesome. When you go to this bar, and I've always likened it to an indoor-outdoor live show, you know, and you've got 3 or 4 different bands going simultaneously, and in between, they're making all these drinks that are just unbelievable. And they're having mullet tosses all over the place. You know, it's just a blast.
It
really is.
It's havoc and mayhem. And I love it because it's basically spring break for adults.
It is. Yeah. And you'd be surprised how many prominent coaches in the SEC you might run into that time of year. If you go in May, you know, during that period where they can't recruit and spring ball is over and they're getting ready for their spring meetings, you know, coming up maybe a week or two later, they'll fudge and come down from Oxford, Mississippi, or Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and Auburn, Alabama, places like that. And for a long period of time, the Northeast and the Midwest had not discovered that area. That's why we aptly called it the Redneck Riviera for many, many years. But now, guys like you from the Chicagoland area, guys like you from the I see license plates from Michigan, Illinois, all the time down there now. So I think a lot of people understand that Destin has gotten so big and so commercialized that, you know, you might be able to dine out a little more quickly if you went to the Floribama or if you went, you know, closer to the Alabama line.
Yeah.
But, you know, years ago when you were from Louisiana, the first beaches that were really prepared were in the Tampa St. Pete area, Clearwater right. Beach. Now it's just
one for you.
It's continued to move west year after year after year.
I got one for you over there in Pensacola. It's a very good barbecue place. It's called Brothers Barbecue.
I'm aware of it. Yeah.
You know Brothers Barbecue. Oh, yeah. That's good stuff. It's kind of like the Shed, right? Yeah. If you've never been to the Shed, you're missing out. In fact, I got my last year's Thanksgiving turkey. I got a smoked turkey from the Shed. I had him send it out. It was so good. The best turkey I've ever had.
You know, it is. I could get lost there. I've on two different occasions almost bought condos there, and I still may. That it's amazing though. About every 5 years they have to rebuild because of a hurricane, but they always do. You know, within like 2 years, boom, they're back up and going again. But it is just a great spot. It is. I've had great times in Vegas, and I always love going west. But that's my favorite spot with my downtime is right along that Florida-Bama line. And it includes Fort Walton, Destin, Panama City, you know, all that. The 30A area is just remarkable. This is a pretty – the water is – the beaches and the water are just immaculate.
They're just crystal. Hey, listen, we've got a few minutes left in the segment. I don't know if you're writing any books or if you're writing, you really need to write a series of books.
Yeah.
I want to hear about it. Take a quick minute and talk about that.
Well, I am. I'm in the middle of one right now. And I say in the middle of it, I'm actually just beginning it. You touched on what my studio looks like up here. And I used to do my show from here when it was on. And, I've got a lot of artifacts and a lot of periods in my career, which is now, you know, I started in 1979, so it's well past five decades. And when I went on national television for the first time, it was 1984. 85, I got to ESPN, and, you know, that's a long time. And when you think about that and the different people that you've worked with, Bill Raftery just had a birthday. And Raft and I have been together. He's the only guy I've worked with that I've actually worked with all five decades, going back to his earliest days at ESPN, my earliest days at ESPN. And we also worked together for the 18 years I was at CBS. And I followed him a year later over to Fox. And I've been working with him at Fox and FS1 for the last 8 years. I'm about to start my ninth year at Fox. So I've worked with, you know, all these different legends, whether it's Al McGuire, Dick Vitale, Billy Packer in basketball alone. And in football, the hits just keep on coming. You mentioned G-Man. I worked with for 10 years at CBS that you have on regularly. There are a lot of stories in there. And I think the way that I want to put the book together is not biographical, but, you know, what to do and what not to do. And maybe help young broadcasters in navigating their way through a very competitive business. And not many people have worked as long as I have at four different networks, which I have over that five decade period. And those relationships that you build are what sustains you, you know, through all of the ups and downs of the business. And whenever I have an opinion to give, we call it On Brando, because I'm always on. So that's going to be the name of the book, On Brando. Okay.
On Brando. That's great stuff. And a big thanks for Tim Brando for joining us today here on the Sports Circus. Lots of fun. And of course, you're always welcome back just anytime. The stories are great. And unfortunately, we're out of time. So ladies and gentlemen, we're going to see you in about 23 hours. Thanks for joining us today. And thanks for Tim joining us as well. And we'll see you then. Until then, so long, everyone.
Can your IRA stand up to the next financial crisis that our top economists are saying is at our doorsteps? By allocating a percentage of your IRA into physical gold and silver with a tax-free rollover, you can diversify and safeguard your holdings from turbulent markets and economic downturns by putting your IRA back on the gold standard. Find out how to safeguard your assets with a tax-free rollover with a Genesis Gold IRA, the only IRA that can hold physical precious metals.
Call now for your free gold and silver report. Protect your IRA today with one simple phone call and learn how to qualify for up to $10,000 in free silver. Call Genesis Gold Group, empowering faith-driven stewardship. 800-932-5517. 800-932-5517. 800-932-5517. That's 800-932-5517.